about burying things in the ground. I remember when I was a little kid, I had this little makeshift wallet with $5 in it, and I went to the beach with my friends, and I buried it in a hole, and I could never find it again. So, and last week I was at St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Port Huron. They were celebrating their 100th anniversary, and I was invited because I was their last intern. I don't know exactly why I was the last intern. They never told me. They're too nice to say. But I was their very last intern, and so I was invited to speak. And again, it makes me nervous when people bury things in the ground, because one of the things they did at their party celebrating 100 years was that they were going to exhume, they were going to dig up their time capsule that they buried like in 1975. And so on the property of St. Paul Lutheran Church on West Water, there's like 12 holes in the ground that they couldn't find. They finally found it. Somebody had marked the spot, and then somebody mowing the lawn moved it. So. But I have more to say about burying your treasure in the ground. Would you pray with me? Our gracious and our faithful and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the joy of this season. We live in a time, it seems, of chaos, of uncertainty, of suspicion and violence. It is all the more important then, Heavenly Father, give us your grace that we might truly be light in the midst of the dark, salt in a world that has lost its taste. May others look to us and see in us, in our life together as St. Mark, and in our lives as we head out through the door, the power of Jesus Christ. For we come in his name. Amen. Every Sunday when I stand here, every Sunday, I am always mindful of the fact that no matter how good the economy may be, no matter how well things are going in the lives of many people, there is at least one person, probably more than just one, but there is at least one person who has entered those doors, who sits in those pews, and who is hurting deeply. On All Saints Sunday, I look out on a crowd of people, and I don't wonder if people are hurting. It is always my hope and my prayer every Sunday, but especially in All Saints, that people who come will find comfort in the warmth of God's house, that they will feel God's strong arms and promises wrapping around them and holding them close, that everyone who comes will be tempted to hope by the wild and outrageous and extravagant promise of the resurrection. Now this Sunday, though, I have to say, the chances are slim to none that people will have that kind of experience. And I can imagine somebody saying, well, that's a strange thing to say. And all I have to do this morning is direct you to the opening lines of Zephaniah. Trust me, in 30 plus years of pastoral ministry, and who knows how many opportunities, occasions where I've been called into the midst of loss and grief, no one has ever said to me, Pastor, let's skip the 23rd Psalm. Would you read from Zephaniah, especially that part where it says, the blood is poured out like dust. It just does something to me when you read that. No one has ever done that, and I suspect no one ever will. It's a funny thing that we come to church this morning, we come with the expectation that we're going to hear something, thinking what we need to hear from God in his wisdom, and in his wisdom, God actually ends up saying something completely different. This morning, in a word, the broad overarching theme this morning, if you haven't catched it, is judgment. Judgment on Jerusalem, judgment on the world, judgment on your life, on my life. In great love, the one who fashioned the world from the stuff of Adam's, who said it was good, it has become a mess. And the good news in the midst of all the judgment is God is not content to leave it that way. And so God speaks to us. God appeals to us in the prophets. In Paul this morning, as the prophets before him, he says, the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night, and the day of the Lord, my brothers and sisters, is not too good. Someone once said a prophet's quarrel with the world ultimately is a lover's quarrel. If prophets and if God didn't care at all, those men wouldn't stand in the midst of the street to be, have rocks thrown at them and spit on them, and in love and with tears in their eyes to tell the world that if they don't change their ways, they are surely on their way to hell. In the words of our text this morning, I hear a voice that rises up and asks each and every one of us a hard question. What are you doing with what has been given to you? And that question this morning finds clear expression in the parable that Jesus tells us this morning, a parable that tells us straightforward, without any equivocation at all, of what God expects of us. And it is also, I think, a glimpse into the mystery of God. God, this morning, comes across hard-nosed and unyielding like a cigar-chopping CEO who has only eyes, not for people, but for the bottom line. It is important to remember that people are complex. I have never met a simple person. All people are many-sided wonders. And often I find myself saying to people, why should God be any different? Maybe that is the reason why instead of one parable about God and the kingdom of God, we have 40 parables. I'm dating myself this morning, and if anybody recognizes what I'm about to say, you're dating yourself too. Do you remember the old Wendy's commercial? The old lady, short of stature. You've heard it.
The sermon's over.
Well, I expected Gary would. I knew that he would know about it, right? You remember? Yeah. Where's the beef? Where is the beef? Well, as good Lutherans, we have a tendency to look at texts and to say, where is the grace in all of this? Where is that unconditional acceptance? Where is that resilient kindness? Where is that love that we say, will not let me go because I'm having a hard time finding it this morning? But I'm telling you this morning, it's right there, right at the beginning. It says, Jesus says, he gave, five, he gave. A talent was a monetary figure. A talent was roughly 15 years' wages. So we're talking about a fair bit of cash. A fair bit of cash. He gave five. He gave two. He gave one, depending on their ability. So the question is, what have you done with what has been given to you? Most instances, and many of you know this to be true, when a child enters the world, they take that adorable lump of flesh and they clean it up, and they measure him, and they weigh her, and they put a shirt on them, and they put a diaper on, please, and they wrap them in a warm blanket, and they put that little beanie on their head, and boom, there she is, in your arms, your delight, your little girl. You take note of all that is there. You count 10 fingers and 10 toes, and you ask yourself, as I did twice, how will this life unfold? What will she, he, become? I see this as I take a good look at her beautiful face. She has her mother's nose. That's good. But that poor kid has grandpa's ears, I suspect. But the question is really, what is on the inside? What will they become? What will they do with what has been given to them? If it is true, as Jesus tells us, that God is something like a father, then why would it be any different for God when God looks at you? God is not a cigar-chomping CEO, only interested in the bottom line, but a heavenly Father whose earnest desire is that each and every one of us would grow up into the full stature of Christ, that all the gifts and the blessings and the talents that have been put into you will come to full flower, that your life will come to bless others and to bless the work of the church in the world. Your love fathoms deep and light years wide. God God comes to us in Jesus and stands before us, waving his arms, trying to get our attention. He asks and essentially says to each and one of us today, use it or you will lose it. Use what you've been given or you will surely lose it. He is not here to beat you up. He is not here to beat you down, but in essence to say to you, and to speak of a law that is as mutable as the law of gravity. If the gifts you have been given, you hoard, if the things you have been given, you clutch and hold to your chest, a life ultimately that you choose to play safe with is a life, a precious life, that is totally and completely wasted. In my life, I have stood the graveside of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people. 90 times out of 100, people speak of their loved ones and the impact that they had on their lives. But I can tell you, and this may seem harsh to you, but you weren't there. I was. They didn't say it to you, they told me. How sad it is. How sad it is to walk out of the cemetery and to get the sense from those that even bothered to show up that a precious life had been wasted. How sad is that? Someone once said to come through life and come to the point where you face death, which all of us will, and to realize at that moment that you never really lived. That is a sin. To take what has been given, to take what has been given, and in fear to bury it into the ground, that is a tragedy. Every day, you and I have a choice. Every day. I steer the ship of my life by 3 stars, called faith, hope, and love, or I steer the ship of my life by 3 stars called anger, fear, and doubt. Jesus, who never played it safe, who risked everything on the cross, that you could live your life and navigate by faith and hope and love. To live with a sense of wonder that circumstances can never control. To breathe deep. Unclench your jaw. Unclench your fists. And live with holy and reckless abandon. You remember the Actor's Studio? Do you remember James Lipton?
Mm-hmm.
Remember, I don't even know if that show's on anymore. James Lipton would stand there with some acting luminary, and at the end he would ask a couple of questions. I remember one of them, what is your favorite curse word? I won't go into that this morning. But the last question was this. If heaven really exists, what would you like to hear God say when you come to that moment and you stand in front of the pearly gates? Some of the responses have been really interesting. The one that I thought was the best was Steven Spielberg, who said, I would love to have God say to me,